let's get started. So we have been doing images for a while, and then starting last week, we started with different types of data. For instance, a different type of data could be video, which is going to be a bunch of consecutive frames of images. And the task that we are interested in for now, at least to begin working with video data sets, was a classification task. A video comes in and we want to classify it. For instance, it could be action recognition. What is happening in this video? Or what type of sport is this video about, etc. But then there are more complex tasks using video, like video to video translation, segmentation for videos when you want to be consistent in time. You can do object detection, object tracking, and in all of those cases, you want to be consistent in time. So there is an entire field in front of us when it comes to videos and working with video data. But I think for now, we covered four important papers in this field. And now let's continue with the next one, which is about non-local neural networks. So the method that's being introduced in this paper and the next one, they not only are applicable to videos, you can apply them to your images as well, or even beyond that. But the main application of non-local neural networks is videos. It's introduced for videos. We learned about kinetics data in the last session. There is another data set that I encourage you to do exploratory data analysis on it if you have time, or even after the semester ends, if you are interested in videos. But what is a non-local operation? Let's take a look at this general form, and then I'm gonna owe you a lot of details and specific definitions for these terms. So there is yi, 1 over c of x, the summation of f of xi, xj, g of xj. So I need to tell you what is I, what is j, what are you summing over, what is x, what is y, what is f, what is g, and what is c. So I owe you these terms. Let's start with I. If we had an image, this I could be the indices for our pixels. Now that you have a video, there is also a time dimension. So I is indexing not only the x coordinate of your image, the y coordinate, but also its time coordinate. So I is indexing everything, the output position in the space and time. J is very similar to I, but what we want to do is that any pixel in the output, we want it to pay attention to all of the other pixels, not only in the space, but also in time. And let's just call them positions. So I is the output position, and we want that I output position to pay attention to all of the possible positions in an image or in a video. What is X? X is our input signal, which could be an image, which could be a sequence, like sentences or a speech, which could be a video, and these are their features. For instance, if you have words, you first come up with your word embeddings, and then that's going to be your features. Or it could be features of the convolution or one convolution layer. So these could be feature maps. So that's your X. It's not only the input image, it could be the features in between your layers. And Y is the output. It's the output signal. It's going to have the same size as X, same resolution and same temporal resolution. And now that we know what is X, we know what is Y, we know what is I, we know what is J, the question is, what is F? F is going to be scalar valued, so it's not a vector. It's going to be scalar valued. It takes as input two arguments, so it's a pairwise function, and it's going to represent some relationship between position I and position J. It could be how much position I is paying attention to position J. And what is G? G takes only one argument, so it's a unary function. Its output could be a vector, because Y could be a vector, and it takes as input the signal value at position j, and xj could be also a vector, okay? But I didn't give you much information up until now. We just expanded these terms. So it's now time to give you examples of what is g and what is f. And c is a normalization factor. So let's take a look at some examples for g and f. G could be a matrix vector multiplication if you have fully connected networks. It could be 1x1 convolution, and it's better to think of this as a 1x1 convolution, not only in a space, but also in time. So that's our G. vector goes in, a vector comes out after matrix vector multiplication. So how are we paying attention to the neighboring points in our image? We can take a look at the dot product. We can actually take a look at the distance between these two points. That's also valid. For instance, this is a vector, that's a vector. You can say xi minus xj, and then the L2 norm of that. Square and push it through your exponential. That's an option. Another distance is this dot product distance. And this is more, it's easier to code this compared to xi minus xj squared because of the operations that we already have implemented in our, I don't know, in TensorFlow or PyTorch. So you look at the cosine similarity distance, and then you take the exponential, and that's going to give you your f, but then you need to normalize this. Otherwise, the exponential is going to explode, and that's the normalization. And after this operation, f divided by c, that's going to give you a softmax. So these attentions are going to be add up to one. They're not going to explode. That's an example. You can take a look at, you can take these xi's and xj's, push them through two functions, phi and theta, and that's going to be called embedded Gaussian. And what is phi, what is theta? They could be one by one convolution. Now you are parameterizing this. You're learning your distance. You're learning your cosine similarity distance through an two embedding matrices. And again, your C is going to be the same as before. So in the end, you're going to get a softmax. Another example could be this phi and theta. You get rid of the exponential, and that's just the dot product of the two. That's another example. And then in that case, your normalization is going to be the number of terms, the number of positions in your x. Could be the number of pixels. Another example is just you take phi of xi, theta of xj, you concatenate them, you multiply them by a weight matrix, and then you take the nonlinearity, you take ReLU on top of that. Again, in this case, your C is going to be n. Then on top of everything, we know what is xi, we know what is yi. Now we can add a residual connection. You take yi, multiply it by a weight for it to have the same dimension as xi. Now you're ready to add them together. And all of these, if you put them together, it's going to give you a non-local block. We learned about convolutions. This is another type of a block. Your input goes in. This could have dimension of your time, a height and a width for your pixels. And then this could be the number of channels. You take x. This is actually how you're going to implement that. You take x, you multiply it by a one by one. You actually convolve it with a one by one by one convolution. Now your dimension changes from 1024 to 512. That's our phi. This is this term. That's theta. This is our phi. Phi is the same. It's a one by one convolution. And then we had another operation here for g. That's also a one by one convolution. Then the way that you're going to implement that is you flatten your tensor into a matrix. You flatten this one into a matrix and then transpose it. Then you multiply these two matrices together. So this dimension, there is a summation on it, so it's going to disappear, and that's going to give you a matrix of THW by THW. And then you do a softmax. I guess it's going to be a row-wise softmax. Now everything is going to add up to one per each row. You take your G, you flatten it, you reshape it, and then you multiply this matrix, which has the size THW by THW 512. So in the end, you're going to get something that is THW by 512. And this softmax is exactly what we just did. It's embedded Gaussian. You do matrix multiplication, matrix vector multiplication, then you reshape it back. Now you want to add something that is 1024 dimensional by 512. You cannot do that. So you push the outcome through another one by one convolution to fix the dimension. This is what we just did here. This is WZ. And then you add your residual connection. So as you can see, this is not very hard to code it up. It's a very simple block, especially, I don't know, if you want to code it in PyTorch or TensorFlow or Keras, etc. It's very easy to implement that. But there is a problem with these attention mechanisms. And the problem is their cost. Each point has to pay attention to all of the other positions in your video or in your image. So per each xi, there is a for loop. Unlike convolutions where this summation is over a small window around xi. This is over the entire xj. So this is not cheap. That's the computational cost. That's not cheap. You can actually make that cheaper. How? Rather than doing your summation over all of xj, all of xj's, over all of your pixels and time snapshots, you can do it over a selected subset. And how do you select it? You can, for instance, take your x, push it through a pooling layer, and then that's gonna reduce the resolution for you. Okay, any questions so far? Is everything clear? So let's see what happens after the training is done. This is a video, and let's say this is our xi. So xi is gonna be a pixel at a particular frame. And we know that each xi is gonna have three dimensions, red, green, blue, or it could be the channel dimension. After the network is trained, this is where this ball is paying attention to. It's paying attention to the head of the person at the same time frame, at different time frames, still at the head of the person, at the head and the ball. So the ball is paying attention to the ball in another time step. It's paying attention to the ball and the head of the person. Okay, let's apply this on a video. And let's say this is your 2D convolution. The backbone is gonna be ResNet 50. So this is exactly ResNet 50. Now we are applying that on a video, perhaps frame by frame. So that's our network. And then we are gonna add the non-local lock. It could be added to the first layer. It could be added to the last layers. If you add it to the later layers in your network, that's a cheaper operation. And this is our C2D baseline on this video, top one and top five accuracy. And we can study these different choices that we have. The Gaussian, embedded Gaussian, the dot product, and concatenation. And you can see all of them are gonna give you a boost in performance. And I don't think this study is decisive between these. Probably it's not decisive between Gaussian embedded, dot product, or concatenation. I think these three are better than this one because they have more parameters. You can also study whether your attention should be only in space, should be only in time, or it could be in space and time. We know that there is a trade-off. There is always a trade-off. Yes, with the space and time, you're getting more accuracy, but there is a cost to it. This is more expensive. You have more points to pay attention to compared to time only or space only. But if you are willing to pay the cost, then that's going to be more accurate. We learned about inflated 3D convolutions in the last session. You can add non-local blocks to inflated 3D, and you can compare it to the baseline by 3D and non-local network. And then yes, you are going to get a boost in performance. It's not only for videos, you can do it for key point detection, or you can also do it for Mascar CNN and apply to COCO dataset. Okay, so it's a block that you can put it in multiple types of networks, and usually you get more accurate results. Any questions? Is everything clear?
I guess I'm not sure how they, how and where you add non-local blocks to some of these networks. I mean, I guess I know how, right? I mean, you just call the block, but where is not clear to me.
Yes, that's a great question, and that one I'm not covering because that's not the main focus of this paper. But that's a great question. If you want to actually implement it, where are you going to put your non-local block? And you need to study that. Should I put it right after the image, the input image? Should I put it right after res 2, res 3, res 4? And we know that there is a trade-off. If you put it right after your image, there is going to be a lot of pixels and a lot of time steps. So that's going to make your method super slow. Or are you going to put it after res 5? Because here the resolution is 4x7x7, and that's going to be very cheap. Okay. So I'm not going through a lot of details, but that one you can find in the paper where they are putting it and what is the trade-off. Okay. Does that sound good?
Yeah. That the trade-off makes sense to me.
But yes, you're right. I'm not telling you where they are putting it. Any other questions?